Hello, my name is J. Paul Massey Singh, Chair of the Brampton Board of Trade. And on behalf of the Board of Trade and Rogers Television, welcome to the federal candidates debate for the riding of Brampton South. The purpose of this debate is to give you, the viewers, an opportunity to better know the candidates in your riding and understand where they stand on key issues, both locally and nationally. We're pleased to be joined today by three candidates. From the Conservative Party of Canada, Kyle Seeback.
Thanks, J. Paul.
From the NDP, Amarjit Sangha.
Thank you.
And from the Liberal Party, Sonia Sidhu. Prior to this recording, the candidates drew numbers to determine the order in which they'll be speaking. Each candidate will have the opportunity to make a brief opening statement, after which time our panel of community members will ask questions regarding to issues of the day. The candidate to whom the question is posed will have time to answer, after which other candidates may comment or rebut. Sitting on our panel today are members of both our business and our non-for-profit community. Firstly, David Clement, Executive Director of Rapport Youth and Family Services. Susan Crawford, past Chair of the Brampton Board of Trade. And Albert Massey, a member of the Diversity and Inclusion Committee at the Brampton Board of Trade. At the conclusion of the question period, each candidate will have the opportunity to make one final statement directly to you, our viewer. With that said, the candidate who drew the first number is Kyle Seeback, and I now turn it over to him. Mr. Seeback?
Great, thanks, J. Paul. It's been my real pleasure and privilege to be your Member of Parliament for the last 4 years. I've worked hard to try and represent you, and I did a number of things that hasn't really been done in politics in Brampton in a long time, and I'll give you a couple of examples. I held dozens and dozens of town hall meetings where everyone was invited because I wanted to hear about the issues that were important to you. We also had what I call MP clinics. We went to people so they could have their problems solved by my office. We went to places of worship. We went to community centers. We went to rec centers so people could come to us and have their federal issues solved. Because for me, the biggest thing about being your Member of Parliament is actually taking the time to serve you and serve your needs. You know, I sent out a lot of information over the 4 years as well, because I wanted people to know what we were doing in Ottawa. I told people about the bills we were studying, the bills we passed. And in fact, on many occasions, I sent you information and said, this bill is coming up in Parliament. What do you think? How do you think I should vote? And in several circumstances, it actually made me decide to vote a way different than I thought I was going to vote, because I take representing you, the people, exceptionally seriously. You know, I'm also an unabashed booster of downtown Brampton. I've worked hard to make sure that our businesses there thrive because it really is the jewel in the city of Brampton. I know other people in Brampton might be offended, but I think downtown Brampton is just absolutely the best part of Brampton. You know, who your local MP matters because it has a direct impact on your connection with the government. And I've worked hard to make sure you have that direct connection with me. When we talk about other things, we talk about the amount of infrastructure that was delivered to Brampton by our government. We can talk about investments in transit, Zoom, the Acceleride bus program. We can talk about investments in community centers to rehabilitate them. We did lots of that as well. And finally, we can talk about investments in affordable housing. Lots of money was invested in many places in Brampton over the last 4 years, Villa Polonia, Snellgrove Place. So not only have I worked hard to represent you and keep you informed about what I'm doing and being accessible, I've also made sure that we're delivering the results for Brampton so Brampton can continue to be a great place to live, work, and play. Thanks very much. I hope I have your support on October 19th.
Thank you, Mr. Seeback. Mr. Sangha, your opening comments?
Thank you, J-Paul. My name is Amarjit Sangha, and I'm running from Brampton South. First of all, I would like to thank viewers, then thank the organizers who has given me this opportunity to connect with the viewers of Brampton South. As we all know, our conservative plan has failed. Too many seniors are retiring in poverty. Too many parents are struggling to find an affordable childcare. And Canada's international reputation is not there where it was. Our public institutions like door-to-door mail delivery services and CBC has been cut. The environment has been ignored. Scientists have been ignored. First Nation have been ignored. Even our veterans have been ignored by this government. We need to change this. We need to change this attitude. This campaign is about change. The people of Brampton South are ready for change. Tom Mulcair and NDP is ready for change. We have a concrete plan. We will work with small businesses to create jobs. We will invest in innovation to stimulate manufacturing sector. We will provide municipalities with stable long-term funding and infrastructure deficit to stimulate our economy. A predictable funding where municipalities can believe on it that funding is coming. MP has to work for a city for municipalities. As we all know, Pan American Games just went by. Only city of Brampton in the region, I believe, didn't get nothing. There was no games and no infrastructure was built due to lack of communication between federal and municipality. This is the job of Member of Parliament. I will do the job right, and I'll bring all the fundings we can get for the riding and all the amenities we need to build this Brampton stronger and better. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And Ms. Sidhu, your opening comments.
Thank you, Jaipal. I would like to thank Rogers and the Brampton Board of Trade and the viewers. Thank you for hosting the debate today. I'm running to be your next Liberal MP for Brampton South because I'm deeply concerned about the direction of our country is going. And I want to help people in the community and right across the country. I'm a healthcare professional who live in riding from 13 years and work in the riding from 13 years. I live here with my husband and three children. Every day, I have the privilege of helping people get better. I love this aspect of my job. For me, public service is about doing better, and I believe we can change for the better. I have deep roots in the community where I have volunteered with a number of local organizations, including Trillium Health Center and my children's public schools, and a variety of environmental groups and charities. Over the years, I have seen Brampton South grow, diversify, and transform. However, our community and our country is facing challenge and hardship. Under Harper, the rich are getting richer, and our middle class is struggling. I have knocked on a lot of doors. I have talked to the people about their hopes and their concerns. People in Brampton South want real change. They want a government that is focused on creating jobs and investing in transit and infrastructure. They want a government that can manage the economy. That's why I'm running for Justin Trudeau and the Liberal Party. With hope and hard work, we can get our country back on a track and build a better Brampton. Thank you.
Thank you very much. With that, we'd like to turn it over to our panelists to ask some questions of our candidates. Mr. Clement, I think you're going to lead us off.
Yes, I would love to. The first question is for Mr. Seeback. Youth unemployment in Peel is about 19%, and that's way above the national average. How will you work to address the issue of opportunities for young people in our community? And most importantly, what role will incentives for business play in your plan?
Well, I'm going to talk about a couple things quickly. I know I only have a minute. So one of the things that I did when I became the Member of Parliament is I looked at our summer students' job program, and it was designed for what were called festivals. I looked at that and said, these are not the kind of jobs we want for our students in the summer. They could work at festivals in a beer tent or something like that. It made no sense to me. I changed the program. I said, let's have a program where the focus is on not-for-profit organizations and small businesses, so our students would actually get good and effective summer jobs with experience they can have for the rest of their life. Of course, we want to make sure students have jobs as well. That's why we're doing things to try and make sure business is successful. When we have our businesses that are thriving, they're going to have more employment, more jobs for students. So you look at things like reducing the corporate tax rate, reducing the small business tax rate, providing more support for internships, $40 million invested to support up to 3,000 internships for students, $260 million in Canada for graduate level students who have demonstrated a high level of achievement, $330 million being invested in our youth employment
Thank you.
Strategy.
Thank you, Mr. Seeback. We'll come back to that and we'd like to get a few more people in on this. Ms. Sidhu?
Hi, I just have a question for Ms. Seeback. If that's the case, why Brampton South's unemployment, youth unemployment is very high? And it's more than the national number, which is 6.8.
And I believe youths are being neglected. If we look at from Prime Minister King up till now, your record is second worst for creating jobs for youths. There are very few jobs for youths, and youths are coming out of university colleges, and they don't have much jobs available here. If they are available, they are low paying and less benefits. And what is going on with the government? They didn't create anything for youths. I believe they don't even think for the youths.
Mr. Seeback?
Yeah, I'd love to have the opportunity to respond. The great thing about quoting statistics is you can take them completely out of context, which is exactly what both of these people have just done. Look at what's going on in the world, be it a massive global recession. In fact, unemployment rate for young people and students is 2 and 3 times higher in a lot of our competitive source other countries. So yeah, 6.8% is the figure my liberal opponent suggested. Maybe that's too high, of course it is. We want everyone employed, but guess what? It's so much better than what's going on in every other country in the world. So you have to take these things into context. We always want to do better, but we are doing better than our other countries that we compete with, and that's what we're going to continue to do. The plan is working. It's doing better than every other country.
It is not working. It's 60,000 less jobs we have than they took office in 2006. Their plan is not working. We need to change our government.
No, 1.2 million net new jobs since the depth of the recession, 80% full-time, 60% high wage.
We had a discussion. We want to make sure that everyone gets an opportunity to speak. So please let me know, and we'll make sure that you have an opportunity to get your opinion across. But we don't want everyone speaking over each other. Ms. Sidhu, did you want to weigh in on this?
Yes. I know when I'm door knocking, I met all the young people. Even being a mother, three kids like who has graduated, they don't get any job. Job is a huge issue in our riding. In Brampton South, I'm meeting most of the young kids. They don't get any job at all. So system is failing. This is the only liberal government. We are spending more in youth jobs, and their system is failing.
Mr. Sangha, you want to continue?
Youth is energy, and they need to be put somewhere. Target them and put them on the track. On the right track means Canada good for our future. If youths are not getting jobs, means we don't have much future left for our youths, for Canadians. We need to put them on work so they can bring the money home, pay taxes, get this country back on track, which we had for years and years and years. But conservative government has not created any jobs for youth, not only youth, for none of the Canadians. 400,000 jobs were lost in manufacturing sector, and people are asking for work. There's none available.
I'm going to bring Mr. Seeback back in. He's been wanting to speak. But I'd like to come back to both Mr. Sangha and Mr. Sidhu. Ms. Sidhu, what I'd like to hear is perhaps what your parties have to say about job creation as opposed to just the record and the status of where we are right now. Mr. Seeback?
Well, Jay Paul, thanks. That's where I was going to go, actually. I was going to say what we heard is we need to do more. We need better jobs. We have to do this. We've heard there's no jobs. Well, in fact, that's not true. There are jobs for youth. But they have no plan. I've detailed what our plan is. I've detailed what I've done as a member of parliament to intervene directly to make sure we're getting good quality jobs for our students in the summer. I talked about the $330 million that we've invested in the youth employment strategy. We can talk about apprentices. We've invested $100 million to help with the red seal trades to make sure young people can go into trades. There's incredible opportunities through apprenticeships and trades, and we're investing in that as well because we think those are great opportunities for young people. But I'd like to hear what the plan of the other parties are and how they're going to do better.
Mr. Sangha, specifics on the NDP approach?
Yes, we will have innovation programs. So companies hire youth, they should get some incentive. So we can get our youth to work, to bring their intelligence to work, to bring them to work. So that's our plan is we will give them incentive if people hire companies hire youth for their employment. And youths would love to work if they are available, if they have work. So they'll be contributing to our country. They'll be contributing to taxes. And they'll be being a help in Canada instead of being sitting on the road depressed. And they're getting all kind of work which is not available. But we have a talent. But nothing much to do because the economy is going down and no jobs are being created by a conservative government, and conservative government has failed plan. It didn't work for 10 years and it will not work further. We need to change our government, bring the NDP government. Innovations would get a benefit from government, and they're inventing something.
Thank you.
They will get a benefit.
Thank you,
from
Mr.
government.
Ms. Sidhu, the details of the liberal approach to this problem.
Yes, we are investing because we think future generation is our, youth is our future generation. We are investing 1.3 billion over 3 years. We are creating 40,000 youth jobs over the next 3 years. And we are also expand our pre-apprenticeship training programs, which help employers create new co-op placement. New co-op placements we are giving into the technology, engineering, mathematics, and business students. We are also restoring a youth service program to help young Canadians gain work and life experience participating in community and building projects. And I just want to tell you the fact Conservative government, they cut the 20,000 position from the Canada summer job recently.
Mr. Seeback.
Well, Mr. Sangha said their NDP is going to have incentives, but of course we didn't hear what the incentive was. So we're going to do more, we're going to have an incentive. Well, what's the incentive that's going to be for business? I told you some of the things we did. We heard from Ms. Sidhu say, well, they're going to invest $1.3 billion over 3 years for youth employment. Well, we're doing that. We're doing $330 million a year, and we have been doing that. We're making those kind of investments. But again, when you talk about summer student jobs, the previous program in this riding was the Liberal program. They thought it was a great idea for summer students to work in festivals. So they would take tickets or, you know, serve food or serve beer. That was their idea of a good summer student job program by the federal government. I said, that's outrageous. We want kids to get good experience, good jobs that will give them lessons and skills they can use for the rest of their life. That's why I changed the entire program. I put the focus on small business and not-for-profit organizations. Kids now are getting exceptional experience through the Canada Summer Students Job Program, which they were not getting under the previous government and the previous Liberal Member of Parliament.
Thank you very much, Mr. Seeback. Perhaps we'll bring on another question for our candidates, and where would you like to take the conversation as proper?
Well, I'm going to switch from local issues to international, and I'd like to talk about the refugee crisis in Europe. My question is to Mrs. Sidhu. Canada has a long history of being a safe haven for refugees who need to flee their homeland, and I think it's a reputation that Canadians are proud of. My question is twofold with respect to the current refugee crisis in Europe. First, has Canada's response to the crisis been sufficient? And second, how do we as a country balance our needs for safety and security against our moral obligations to the refugees and the rest of the world?
Thank you for the question. This response, the Harper government, we all feel it was shameful, and I must say an embarrassment compared to past historical responses. The Liberal government will take immediate action to bring 25,000 Syrian refugees to Canada and address the tragic crisis. We are investing at least an additional $100 million this year to increase refugee processing without reducing standard, as well as sponsorship and settlement services capacity in Canada, and provide an immediate $100 million new contribution to the United Nations High Commission for Refugees.
Mr. Seeback?
Well, look, I think you have to do three things when you're deciding what to do with a refugee crisis. And let's be clear, there's an enormous crisis going on over there. 11 million people have been displaced, 4 million internally, 7 million internally, 4 million externally. We have a three-pronged approach. Number one, we want to provide humanitarian assistance. And of course, we're doing that. We're sending humanitarian assistance to the region, $503 million for humanitarian assistance. Number two, we have to stop the creation of refugees. We have to stop the crisis that's going on in that region. And we're doing that as well. We're participating as part of the international force to stop and degrade ISIS. Neither one of my opponents want to have Canada involved in that. Their plan is simply to try and deal with refugees as they come. But if we don't stop what's going on there, we do not stop the refugees. And what we have now will continue to expand and get worse. Finally, we want to bring refugees. And in fact, we have. To this date, 22,000 Iraqi refugees have been resettled in Canada. Approximately 2,500 Syrian refugees have been brought to Canada as well. We are also going to bring a further 11,300 Syrian refugees by September of 2016. We have to balance bringing refugees in to making sure we follow the process we always follow, do our due diligence, make sure we're doing our security checks, but we have to have all three things as part of the plan. The other two parties only have certain parts of that.
Thank you, Mr. Seeback. Mr. Sangha, has our response been the appropriate one?
Our plan is, why are these refugees being created? Dropping bomb is not a solution. We don't need to drop a bomb. They need a food. They need a help. They need a hope. That's what NDP government would offer them. That's what NDP stands for. We will go into only with the UN-led missions, not to fight somebody or to kill somebody or drop a bomb in the region of any of this area, anywhere in the world. NDP has laid out a concrete plan to tackle the Syrian refugee crisis. We can bring by getting 10,000 Syrian refugees by the end of this year and 46,000 in the next 4 years. So this is the way we have to help them. They need our help. And we need to talk about it. We don't need to drop a bomb. We don't need to do a military action on them. And they need a food. They don't need bombs. That's what NGP stands for. And we are a peacekeeping country, and we want to remain that way.
I think we all agree that we have a role to play in helping those who are in need, and that we want to have our doors open to refugees. The complexity in this particular issue, however, is balancing the needs of safety, security at home. Mr. Seeback touched a little bit upon that. Ms. Sidhu, can you comment on that part of this question as well?
I think when the before Harper government said they are accepting more, but how many, can Mr. Seeback said, how many Syrian refugees came before? Now the pressure built on the government, now they are accepting 10,000. Mm-hmm.
But specifically to the question of the government in power today is saying, we need to balance that out against the needs security-wise. We need to make sure the individuals who are coming in are people who we can help and who ultimately will contribute. Is there a part of that to the Liberal plan as well?
Yes, humanitarian basis always the priority of the Liberal government. It's always like that. But one thing I want to tell you, mm-hmm. Conservative government is always this fear-mongering. We also need to check the security, but also we have to humanitarian aid. We accept Canada's has always reputation. We have to keep that reputation on that.
Mr. Sangha and then Mr. Seeback.
Well, our security, I don't think we have any problem with our security. If refugees are coming, if there are one or two are not the one who should be here, we can deport them. There shouldn't be a problem. But they're making excuses. We have people who are here. They cheated in the elections. But they are still here. So if refugees are coming with the background, which not should be in Canada, we can deport them immediately. It doesn't take long to put them on a plane and send them back.
Mr. Seeback, you care to comment?
Well, number one, my NDP opponent doesn't understand how the system works. You don't just deport someone immediately. There's a long process. And so he misunderstands fundamentally how that works. Look. We have to do all three things, and that we're the only party that's doing that. We've got three things. There has to be military intervention. The other two parties says they're not. Mr. Sangha says don't drop bombs, drop food. The fact of the matter is, anybody who watched the news saw the massive and rapid expansion of ISIS. It was only until there was international force there to stop them that they didn't expand further. If we're not there militarily stopping them from expanding, there's going to be a huge influx of refugees. And in fact, how people from that region have said, if we don't stop ISIS and just drop food, you'll end up dropping food on dead bodies, because this is one of the most vicious regimes we've ever seen. And we're the only party that's going to do all three things. We're going to balance the need for security, we're going to continue our humanitarian and compassionate aid, and we're going to be a beacon for these people to come and get out of the region. But these people don't want to be all depopulated from the region. Those are their homes. They want to be there, and we have to help provide them the security so they can stay as well.
Thank you, Mr. Seeback. Mr. Sangha.
Yeah, I don't know what channel Mr. Seeback sees. When I see on news, I see people crying. Kids are crying. Sitting in the hot weather and sitting on a border, sitting on a railway station, waiting for trains to come to take them somewhere else to opportunity land so where they can settle their life, where they can breathe, where they can have a food, where they can have a peace. That's what they want. That's what I see in the news. Which channel Mr. Seeback sees?
They're crying because
they're
driven out of their homes. They're crying because they're driven out of their homes and they're fleeing a murderous regime.
Gentlemen, Mr. Sangha, continue.
Sorry. So we need to protect them. We need to give them hope. We need to give them help. That's what Canadians are all about. We have been helping in the past, and we need to keep helping people who are in need, and that's what Canadians are for, I believe.
Ms. Sidhu, the last word on this topic is yours.
I know it is a critical issue like this one that define us as a nation. We need a new federal government that is compassionate and balanced with their response. As an MP, I would have advocated much harder on matters such as the Syrian refugee crisis.
Thank you, Ms. Sidhu. Mr. Massey, what would you like to ask our candidates?
Well, we touched a little bit about youth unemployment, which continues to be an important issue here. But I'd like to broaden the discussion a little bit on that. And Mr. Sangha, what I'd like to ask you is that about 40% of the jobs that have been created in the last 10 years have come from the small business section. So what can the federal government do? What role does it play in helping small businesses grow? And more specifically, what are your priorities for Brampton?
Well, for small business, as most of our viewers know, NDP has a plan to reduce the taxes on small businesses. from 11 to 10% in the first budget to 9 in second budget. This is the way we grow a business. Reducing tax on businesses and giving them opportunities. If they are inventing anything, we need to be a part of it and give them incentives to hire youths. And this is the way we will build our economy. And Brampton needs jobs. Brampton is a sleeping city, I believe. There's not enough jobs. There are no business people stay in Brampton and work somewhere else. The commuting is difficult. We need to build a better transit system, better transportation. We need better roads. We need better infrastructure. Bring money for city, predictable, where cities can depend on the money and they knew the money would be there when they need it. Not like conservative governments. If they give them a project, they would take years to get the money out of their doors. By the time, the prices are higher. Nothing can be achieved. But we will plan it, give them money, and give them incentive to
Thank you, Mr. Sangha. Employ more.
Ms.
Sidhu, the approach to small business, and particularly the local impact that you can make.
I think small businesses are our backbone of our economy, and they are creating 80% job to our economy. We are also reducing, Liberal Party is also reducing, lowering the small business tax rate 11% to 9%. We are also reducing employment insurance premises. It's $1.65 in 2017, while also expanding EI benefits. We are also supporting the middle class that has enough money to shop at and support local business in their community. Yes, as Mr. Sangha said, we need a federal partner on the table who work with the provinces and support the businesses.
Thank you. Mr. Seeback, how do we address this issue nationally and locally both?
Well, I want to respond to a couple things I just heard. Mr. Sangha says, you know, there's no businesses, there's no jobs in Brampton. I've met with downtown Brampton business owners many times. There's lots of great, thriving businesses in Brampton, and the downtown is such an important part of the riding of Brampton South. They work hard. To talk to Mrs. Sidhu, I want to, you know, remind viewers of what her leader said about small business. A large percentage of small business are actually just ways for wealthier Canadians to save on their taxes. So describing small business as effectively tax cheats, that is just an unbelievable comment. Look, small business is the creator of the vast majority of jobs in our communities. We have to find ways to make sure that they're succeeding. I can tell you one of the things that I learned when I was talking to the small business in my riding, because I held roundtables about this, is they need money for training. That's the way they can improve their businesses and attract new employees. That's how we came up with the Canada Job Grant, matching funds for small businesses to train employees. If the employer puts in some money, the federal government will put in some money, and the province will put in some money. That's going to lead to further growth for small businesses.
Thank you, Mr. Seeback. Mr. Sangha.
A response to Mr. Seeback's jobs created in Brampton. I've been living in this riding for the past 23 years. I don't remember working for any Bramptonian company, because there are no businesses available, very few jobs. We need more than that. We need to work on it. We need to bring up funds. Recently, at Pan American Games, every other city built infrastructures at the funds from federal help. But our MP was not able to bring anything.
The city of Brampton didn't bid on any of the projects.
You had
I
to
can't
work
deliver
with the
money.
You Seeback? Had to work with Seeback? The city. That's what you elect MP for. And MPs have to work with the city, with the federals. So
city of Brampton had
failed
to bid on projects.
They failed. They are not a negotiator. We have to send somebody who is a negotiator, who can negotiate between city and our feds. If he's bringing their message to Brampton, they won't accept it. We need to be working both ways. We need to take Brampton message to Ottawa, not the other way around. That's what I will do. Vote for me on October 19th.
Thank you, Mr. Sangha. Ms. Sidhu?
As Mr. Kyle Seeback said, Justin Trudeau, that's what he's not said that. It's just misled by the Conservatives. Even in 2007, Justin Trudeau came to Brampton before he ran as an MP, gave a keynote speech for a fundraiser at the Rapid Family and Youth Services, which provides good support for our young people and the business. That is clear evidence that the leader of the Liberal Party is sincerely committed to the young people and our nation, including Brampton, and want to see them succeed of life. Justin Trudeau always said the 80% job creator is the small business. And it's just the book by the Conservative government that's a misled statement.
Mr. Mr. Seeback, I think some comments were thrown your way.
Yeah, look, going to Rapport Youth Services, which is a great organization in Brampton that does great things for youth, has really not, they're not a business. So I don't know how that's an example of Mr. Trudeau helping business. I didn't misquote Mr. Trudeau. That's a direct quote that what he said. And Mr. Sangha again said there's no businesses in Brampton. The hundreds of business owners I meet every year to talk about their needs are going to be very happy to know that Mr. Sangha thinks there's no businesses in Brampton. We have great businesses in Brampton. They provide great jobs, and we're going to work hard to make sure they succeed.
That's what I said. There's no jobs
for Brampton. Mr. Sangha, let Mr. Seeback finish, and we'll get you in.
We have many, many thriving businesses in Brampton, I know. My family moved to Brampton in 1963. This city has expanded through great jobs and employment. We always have to do more. We're trying to do more. We're doing things like lowering taxes, the Canada Job Grant, you know, lowering the reaffirming the Small Business Job Credit. That will reduce payroll taxes by 15%. We know small business is the lifeblood of the economy. And we're going to continue to work hard for them.
Thank you, Mr. Seeback. Mr. Sangha, and then Ms. Sidhu.
Let me tell my Bramptonians, if you look at 410, Highway 410 early in the morning, you see people are driving out of city. Where are they going? They are not going for fun. They're going to work because they need a job. They need to afford their family. They need to pay for their bills. That's what they do because there aren't enough jobs in Brampton, and Bramptonians are being forced to drive, spend more money on fuel, spend more money while traveling, and spend more time traveling, and less time with their families. Because almost 2 to 3 hours it takes them from home to work, from work to home. That's what Bramptonians are facing. We need to create the jobs in Brampton. That's what NDP will do, and that's what I will do.
Thank you. And Ms. Sidhu.
What tangible accomplishment has Mr. Seeback to Brampton? Why didn't he get Brampton to any Panem events? $2.4 billion was spent on the Panem Games. They were hosted by Toronto, but Mississauga and Caledonia hosted some events. If Brampton has hosted some aspect, we would have received funding to build infrastructure such as stadium and fields. Why did my opponent, Mr. Seeback, not deliver tangible infrastructure project for the city of Brampton for the Panem Games? And then now the resident, after finishing the Panem Games, the resident can use the stadium or a track.
We were talking about job creation, but a direct question to you, so I'm going to ask Mr. Seeback.
Look, I'm going to try and explain this as simply as I can. The city of Brampton didn't bid on any of the Pan Am projects. We can't deliver funds to projects that aren't earmarked for Brampton. But I can tell you what we have delivered for Brampton. $95 million for the Zoom bus and AcceleRide program. Investments for affordable housing, Villa Polonia and Snellgrove Place. Rehabilitation of rec centers, $639,000 for the Chris Gibson Rec Center, right in my riding of Brampton South, $245,000 for the Brampton Soccer Center, $379,000 to rehabilitate the Brampton Curling Club, $238,000 for Memorial Arena. I can go on and on and on. There have been millions and millions of dollars of investments in Brampton. That's what I brought as an MP. They want to keep talking about the Pan Am Games? Fine. But you can't give money for projects that don't exist. The city of Brampton decided, for whatever reason, they had a vote on it, they decided not to bid on the projects. I can't deliver funds for projects that don't exist.
But they were existing for Markham, for Mississauga.
Because those cities chose to bid on them. Those cities chose to bid on them.
That's what the job is. You have to talk to a city and tell them that they need to be a part of it.
Thank you,
folks. That's what the job is.
Mr. Sangha, let's get another question on. But you know, before we leave this last one, I just want to say I understand the point that we're all trying to make here, that there's obviously more opportunities to create more jobs for Bramptonians. We want to have our community being put to work. But I feel I'm abdicating my moral responsibilities as the chair of the Board of Trade. If I don't point out, there are 8,000 businesses in Brampton, over 800 of which are members of the Board of Trade, all of which would be eager to work with any of you once elected to help create more job opportunities here in this community. But we are not a community without jobs. We certainly want more. Mr. Clement, what would you like to ask our candidates next?
Well, I think we're going to focus on social needs of the community. Many families, and I should say this question is for Ms. Sidhu. Many families and individuals are unable to find affordable housing. The average wait time for subsidized housing in Peel is 5.3 years. With almost 5,000 new applications for subsidized housing in 2014 alone, the lack of rental housing unit construction, rapid population growth, and increasing in poverty rates have created an almost crisis situation in this region. How will your national long-term strategy address the capital and operational funding needs for a high-growth community like Brampton?
Ms. Sidhu, and again, if you could, your comments to Brampton, please.
Thank you for that question. The wait time is 15 years now. That's unacceptable. What our Liberal Party will do, we will invest in $20 billion in affordable housing and seniors facilities. We are also providing $125 million per year in tax incentive to increase and renovate the supply of rental housing across Canada. We are also expanding the existing home buyers plan, allow Canadian affected to have sudden life changes, use money from RSSP to buy a housing. And that's why we are just spending $20 billion for in affordable housing to provide that housing, and then wait time will be reduced.
Mr. Sangha, strategy?
Well, I think Justin Trudeau will leave to private funds to invest in housing, but NDP government will directly invest in housing. 10,000 units will be built across country, and Brampton is in big need of it, and we don't have affordable housing. People are forced to live in a crowded homes, or kids are sent to shelters where there's no place. So we need affordable housing, and we need a plan for it. Conservatives' plan failed, and Liberals' plan won't work, because Justin Trudeau's plan is not the plan with work for Canada. Private sector investment in that? Absolutely not, because this has to be government, and government has to own it. That's the way we can give an opportunity to those who are in need. We can give this facilities to needies. Thank you.
Mr. Seeback.
Well, I think like many problems, they're complex. And first of all, I disagree that the waiting list is 15 years. I mean, lots of studies show that the wait time is much longer. The list is made up of people who are no longer looking for affordable housing. What we're doing on affordable housing is this, $2.3 billion over the next 4 years for affordable housing. This is the largest investment that's ever been made by the federal government for affordable housing. We've also brought $1 billion for energy and retrofits for units. We also have $2 billion in the Municipal Infrastructure Lending Program. That's going to allow municipalities to access low-interest loans so they can build more low-income and affordable housing. We've seen successes already in Brampton. In the last 4 years alone, in my particular riding of Brampton West, there have been two new projects, affordable housing projects, that have come online, Villa Polonia and Snowgrove Place. Great projects for the community. We're going to continue to work and build on successes like that and find more partnerships to continue to build. It was a great partnership between the Region of Peel, the Government of Canada, and the Province of Ontario. And those are exactly the kind of things we want to work together to make these investments.
Thank you, Mr. Seeback. Mr. Sangha, we talked about the investments that are being made nationally, some of the issues that are here in Brampton, but when we talk about the big investments, the question always comes up, is Brampton getting their fair share of the investments that the government's making?
Of course, every city will get their fair share, and this is the Member of Parliament's job to bring a fair share to the city.
Have we gotten our fair share today?
No, absolutely not. They didn't work. 300,000 Canadians experience homelessness every year. They need a shelter. Being in Canada, being Canadian, it's hard to believe that Canadians are coming on the road, they don't have a home to live, and government failed to provide them. So NDP government will build affordable housing, give a direct money to cities so cities can build it, and feds can help it. We need to work together with cities, provinces, territories, and municipalities, which hasn't been done in the past, and NDP will change it. We will talk to every level of government and bring the funding and build the amenities we need.
Ms. Sidhu, the same question to you. Has Brampton gotten their fair share of this federal funding?
Yes, that's what we are doing. We are investing money. We are sitting on a table as a federal partner to work with the provincial and territories, and then made the project go through. And as Mr. Sangha said, have their plan is costed? No, they want to sit and plan their first. They want 40% from provinces. They didn't talk to the provinces yet. So their plan is not costed, but our plan is costed. That is why we are spending that much money, $20 billion over the 10 years. And we are also investing $6 billion in social infrastructure.
And how much of that's going to come to Brampton? What can we expect to see here as people in your riding?
That's why we said we are sitting with the table. We are a federal partner, which conservative government didn't do that. They are just silent. They are not sitting with as a federal partner with this provincial, and that's what we our plan is to. We just want to go collectively for Brampton. That's why Brampton is not getting any fair share.
Thank you. Mr. Seeback, Brampton and its fair share?
Yeah, of course we're getting our fair share in Brampton, and to say we don't partner up, it just defies the facts that I just actually explained to my colleagues here and to viewers. There's two projects that we just completed in my riding of Brampton South alone, Villa Polonia and Snellgrove Place. Perhaps my colleagues aren't aware of them, but they're great affordable housing units. And they're partnerships with the federal government, the province, and the region of Peel, because it's the region of Peel that is actually responsible for the affordable housing units. Those are exactly the partnerships we want. We're going to continue to build on those partnerships. $2.3 billion a year for the next 4 years on affordable housing. We're making the right investments, we're partnering with the right people, and the plan's going to work. 1,000 new units in my riding alone in the last 4 years of affordable housing. We're getting the job done. There's always more to do, and I'm going to continue to make sure that we get our fair share.
Thank you, Mr. Seeback. Ms. Crawford, what would you like to ask our candidates next?
The question is actually related to what we've been talking about. All the parties' platforms call for investment in infrastructure and other spending, and we've heard today from the candidates about billions and billions of dollars that we can expect to see invested in our communities across the country. I think the question that a lot of people have, and which I'd like to direct to Mr. Seeback, is how will these investments be paid for?
Well, thanks, Susan, for the question. We're running a balanced budget. We're in surplus for the last fiscal year of $5 billion. We're on track to have a surplus in this coming fiscal year and the years ahead. That's been a priority for us. We had to spend when we were in the depth of the global recession to make sure we continued to have jobs. We made great targeted investments. $33 billion under the Building Canada Plan launched in 2007 to make sure we were stimulating the economy in the tough times. But our budget, our campaign platform is fully costed. We're going to make the investments in infrastructure that we need to make, like we've continued to make. In fact, in the previous 10 years of a Liberal government, Ontario received $3.4 billion of investment in infrastructure in the 10 years that they were the government. In the 10 years we've been the government, we invested $12.3 billion, four times more. So those are the kinds of investments we've made. We went into deficit when we had to. We spent when we had to. Our opponents now criticize us for that, but at the time they're saying we should have spent more. But we've brought ourselves back to balance. We're going to continue. We doubled the gas tax fund to give you municipalities, made it permanent, and indexed it. Our new Build Canada plan is $53 billion of investments
Thank
over the next
Mr.
10
Seeback.
Years.
We'll come back. We can talk a little bit further about the investments that have been made. Ms. Sidhu, reference was to the Liberal plan. How are you going to pay for the commitments you're making?
Yes, we are, Justin Trudeau's very honestly said to the Canadian, we are running modest deficit. Yes, because we are investing $125 billion into infrastructure. GDP growth is low. This is, interest is low. This is the best time to spend in our economy. And our opponents say, like we are, they are just not being right. Because why we are in a recession? Why GDP growth is so low? And we are just in deficit. They gave us six consecutive deficit. If the economy is that strong, why we are in recession right now? And what we are doing, we are spending $125 billion into an infrastructure plan. We are investing $1.3 billion over 3 years and creating 40,000 youth jobs. And we are also investing in skill training through $750 million annual increase in funding for training programs.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Sidhu. We'll come back to you. Mr. Sangha, is it more important to ensure that our budget is balanced, or is now the time to make investments, and is it okay to run a deficit?
No, we need both. We need a balanced budget and investments. He's been telling balanced budget. They have grew $150 billion debt on Canada. We don't call it balanced budget. We need more money, but they've been spending money on the wrong spots. Canada municipal infrastructure deficit is staggering, $172 billion and rising. We can blame municipalities. Yes, they owe 60% of our public infrastructure, but only get 8% of every tax dollar. Municipalities had to work, but they need money. Well, feds are keeping all the money and not giving them enough money. Where they spend the money, he calls it a balanced budget, but they did not spend $8.7 billion from previous budget. Where did they cut? Carl Seeback can explain it better, and he should explain it. Where those cuts were made, if they were shown originally in the budget, where you didn't spend that $8.7 billion, can you let our viewers know? Can you let Bramptonians know? What cuts were made in the budget?
Thank you. Mr. Seeback, the question.
Well, I'm going to need more time than 30 seconds because I want to respond to the infrastructure and the deficit talk. Look, when we were running deficits, we had to run deficits because there was a massive global recession. We did it to stimulate the economy. At the time, the both opposing parties said we should spend more. Now they're saying we shouldn't have spent it at all, so their position's inconsistent. When you talk about municipal infrastructure, the time when the decline in municipal infrastructure took place, according to Jack Mintz and his article, was in the 1990s. That's when our infrastructure stock aged dramatically. That's the time when the Liberals were the government. However, since 2006, there's been a sharp increase in infrastructure spending as a share of GDP. That's because of what our government has done. We've made targeted, important investments in infrastructure. We're going to continue to do that with the new Build Canada plan. $53 billion of predictable funding over the next 10 years for municipalities. We're going to make sure we get the job done. Balancing budgets, we balance the budget. It's in the budget. The Parliamentary Budget Officer just agreed. We have a $5 billion surplus for last year. How do we make those savings? Very simply, we found cost savings across all departments, 5 and 10%. We did it through early retirement and efficiencies.
Thank you, Ms. Sidhu.
Yes, I just want to ask Ms. Seeback, how they balance the budget? They took, they sold the GM shares, and they just take some funds from AI from constituency funds. How they balance the budget? Because of the election years, they run six consecutive deficit, and how they balance the budget? That is the thing happened.
Every time I take it to someone else, they throw it back to you, Mr. Seeback.
I'm happy to have it. Of course, we've gone over this. We ran deficits when we had to because of the global economy. And the Liberal Party knows a lot about the EI fund because when they were in power in the 90s, they raided it to the tune of $50 and $60 billion. Look, we balanced the budget quite simply. Yes, we had some GM shares because we bailed out the auto industry to save jobs because we had to. We sold the shares when we could get a fair return on our investment, which is what Canadians would expect us to do with their tax dollars. We're making prudent investments where we need to. We're going to make sure the balance is budget. I actually find it a little scary and frightening that I'm on the same page as the NDP. We're going to make investments and balance the budget. Only the Liberals are saying they're going to spend. And from my review of the spending promises they've had this campaign, they're going to spend wildly, and their deficit will be far greater than what they're suggesting.
Mr. Sangha, you've been eager to comment.
But we will spend money where it's needed for the Canadians who are in need. Balance the budget is must to keep this country going. And we don't want to leave too much debt for our children and grandchildren. Like Liberals and Conservatives have done $150 billion debt on Canada using EI money and using emergency funds, tangerine funds from $3 billion to $1 billion. Showing those funds in the budget doesn't make a balanced budget. This is not the right way of doing. We need to be clear with the public. We need to be clear with the Canadian. We have to be upfront and let them know what is going on. They've been doing everything closed doors, behind doors. No one knows what they've been doing. Now they're saying, oh, it's just like, oh, I had my shirt hanging and there was $5 from last week, I forgot. Come on, $8.7 billion and they don't know where it came from. They could save $8.7 billion, then they would, our debt wouldn't have reached $150 billion in the last 10 years under Conservative government.
Ms. Sidhu.
We costed our plan. That's why Justin Trudeau said we run moderate deficit, but by 2019, we will balance the budget. In the history, we gave the surplus budget. And that's why this is the time. This is the right time. We are spending in. We are investing in economy, $125 billion into the infrastructure, which people need the jobs. That's why we are investing $1.3 billion over the 3 years and creating 40,000 youth job. People need job. People need to spend in economy. That's why we costed our plan, and that's why we are very honest to the Canadian. We are run a moderate deficit, and by 2019, we will be balanced the budget.
Thank you. We're going to take, I know you're eager to comment further, but I want to make sure we get as many questions in as possible for our viewers. So we're going to turn it over to Mr. Massey to ask one more question for us, please.
So we heard a lot about growth in Brampton, and Brampton, Peel Region, is one of the fastest growing communities. It's projected that over the next 30 years, the population growth in Brampton could actually double. So what I'm interested in knowing is what specific steps, I'll start with Mrs. Sidhu here, are you going to take to make sure that Brampton gets a fair, equitable share of investment here locally?
Mrs. Sidhu?
Yes, we are federal partner who will sit in the table, and we work with the provincial and municipalities, and then we get the fair share from the federal government, and we are just giving the priorities which project has to be gone first. And that is why we said that we have the investment to do that, 125 billions for infrastructure. But we are the government. We want to work with the provinces, with the municipalities, to get all the projects moving forward.
Mr. Sangha, and again, the question that Mr. Massey asked specifically, locally, what will you do as an MP, if elected, to make sure that you're representing our community?
Let me tell you, Liberals' plan won't work. They are going in deficit till 2019, and they have no plan coming out of it. How are they going to balance the budget? What are they going to cut in 3 years? What we won't see anymore in our budget, or what part they are going to eliminate from their budget? We have a plan, increasing a direct transfer to municipalities by additional $1.5 billion annually by the end of the first mandate. These commitments more than double the existing transfer to municipalities, bring the total investment to $5 billion annually, and raising with inflation after the first mandate. That plan will create 54,000 jobs for local in cities, and we will get a fair share for Brampton, and this is how Brampton will survive. This is what Brampton needs. That's what NDP has for Brampton.
Mr. Seeback, locally, how would you be continuing to represent us if reelected?
Absolutely. Well, you have to be a tireless and fearless advocate for your city, which I've been, and I can give you a couple of examples of that. $7.5 million to build the Mount Pleasant Mobility Hub. Great money, great investment for the community. $95 million for the Brampton Acceleride program and the Zoom bus program. These are funds that were delivered for Brampton because our members of parliament worked hard to make sure we got those investments. I can tell you other things that we're going to make sure we work hard to invest in. At some point, the city of Brampton is going to make a decision on the LRT. And I can tell you, I will be in Ottawa making sure that we get a share of funding from the federal government for the LRT, because that's the kind of thing you have to do if you're going to represent this community. We can talk about investments that I was able to bring to Brampton with respect to affordable housing. I've talked about them already tonight. $95 million for Villa Polonia and Snellgrove Place. That's what you have to do if you're going to work hard as your local MP. You bring money for projects that benefit your project, whether it's renovating a rec center like I listed, whether it's investing in transit or affordable housing.
Thank you.
That's
Mr.
what
Sangha?
You do.
Well, I don't think he'll be in Ottawa anymore. He has failed doing his job. He didn't bring any money. Pan American Games we had around the GTA. Every city around us got the money to build infrastructure where our players, our kids can practice or do better in their games. Infrastructures could have stayed with Brampton for a very, very long time, but he's not a negotiator. He couldn't bring a cent to city of Brampton. We need somebody who can go to Ottawa and take our problems there, get the solution from there. Don't bring their problems and tell Bramptonians what Ottawa thinks. We need to take our problems and get it done, or get the funds needed for the city of Brampton. That's what NDP will do. That's what I will do.
Ms. Sidhu?
I just want to say I fully support the Brampton LRT. We need to get people moving in this city. And I know when LRT is there, what Mr. Kyle Seeback's stand on LRT? Why LRT is not giving a land? It's fully funded by provincial, not by federal. And why LRT is still not in process?
Mr. Seeback?
Well, I just quite clearly said, once the city of Brampton decides on the route and has a project, I will guarantee that we will have federal money to invest in that project. That'll be my commitment, my personal commitment and pledge to the people of Brampton and the residents of Brampton South. The federal government will contribute to LRT. I support there being an LRT in Brampton, absolutely. I've delivered results in the past for my riding by bringing in money for transit, and I'm going to do it again. I've got the track record. Mr. Sangha says I haven't delivered anything. I don't think he listens when I talk. I listed four projects that I was able to secure funding for my riding of Brampton West at the time, my new riding of Brampton South. I'll continue to be that advocate for the community, just like I'm an advocate for small business, representing
Thank
business
you.
Proudly,
Thank
unlike
you,
Mr. Sangha, who says there's no business.
Thank you, Mr. Seeback. Ms. Sidhu, you had a comment you wanted to make?
I just want to see what Mr. Seeback's stand on LRT. I fully supported LRT. I know Brampton route is in discussion, but still, when fund is there, why it's not going into the process? It creates jobs, and we need a university, and we need a lot in Brampton, and nothing has happened. And I'm the person who want to go in federal, get the money from there, and then go on the projects and get approved everything. I just want to say why LRT is not going forward.
Thank you, Ms. Sidhu. That's all the time that we have for questions right now. Brings the debate portion of our conversation to a close. We're now going to move to closing statements from our candidates. Ms. Sidhu, what would you like to leave with our viewers?
Over the last hour, you have heard from each of us about how we would make Brampton a better place to live. As a healthcare professional and local resident, I have always served my community with passion and worked to make it a better place to live. Over the last 9 years, I have seen the conservative policies are just not working. We are in second recession under Harper's watch. We can continue on this path or we can make another choice. The Liberals have a bold vision and real plan. Brampton needs a federal partner, and I can be the strong voice for our community. True leadership comes through working together towards a common goal. I am Sonia Sidhu. On October 19, I ask for your support to deliver real change. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Sangha, your final thoughts.
Well, thanks for giving us the time. As you are a member of parliament, I'll control myself in the House of Commons, unlike Mr. Seeback, who has been calling his colleague names, which he has to apologize. Bramptonians don't go to parliament to apologize. We will go there to work, and my stand will be on LRT on proposed route. We need to work with the city. We don't leave everything on the city, and we need to give them advice whenever they ask for, even they don't ask for, and we should work with them. We should go to them and convince them if they have any issues, and we try to resolve them or let them know how we can resolve them as Bramptonian. As Bramptonian and as a member of parliament, I'll work for you. NDP has a plan, $15 an hour minimum wage, $15 a day childcare, door-to-door mail delivery, and we will save the CBC, which is a source of income and a source of information for many part of this country. This is what we need to save. This is what Canada is all about. We want to keep the Canada we have. We want to pass on the Canada was given to us, to our children, to our grandchildren. This is what we have to work for. Vote for NDP on October 19th. Vote for Amarjit Sangha. I'll be your voice in Orwa, and I'll work for Brampton. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sangha. And Mr. Seeback, your closing statement.
Great. Thanks, Jay Paul. Look, it's been my incredible honor to represent the voters of Brampton West and now the new riding of Brampton South for the last 4 years. I've loved every minute of it. I've worked hard to be an accessible MP to make sure your voice actually is reflected in Ottawa. I made sure I held community events all the time. I had, like I said in my introduction, I held town halls, dozens and dozens. I met with people in their homes or in their community centers or in their place of worship to make sure we were there to meet their needs. That's what you need as a member of parliament. The actual vote you make is a local vote. Who's going to represent you? And I've worked very hard to represent the residents of Brampton in the last 4 years. And I've delivered results. I talked about it today. Investments in infrastructure, investments in transit, investments in affordable housing. I'm going to continue to work on that record and improve upon that record. It'd be my great honor to be your representative again. And I hope I have your vote on October 19th. Thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Mr. Seeback. That brings our debate to a close, and I'd like to thank the candidates for their participation and, of course, our panelists for their time, as well as you, our viewers, for joining us. On behalf of the Brampton Board of Trade and Rogers TV, we hope you found the discussion to be enlightening and want to please urge you to be sure to vote. Finally, please tune to Rogers TV, cable channel 10 on election night for complete coverage of election results, including in-depth analysis of local ridings. It all begins at 9 p.m. on election night, October 19th. Thank you for joining us.